Okay, and we're starting our co-director tonight. So I believe there are three things that I want to talk about tonight. So one is our COVID-19 response. I want to talk about the various things we are doing. And also, Claudia, since you're here, let me know if there's anything you want to say on the communications front. I'll kick it to you if there is something you want to say, and if there is, when you're ready, just let me know. Just shoot me a text in the chat. So there are a few things right now that we are doing in response to COVID-19. One is acting as an informational resource. So we've created a dedicated webpage on our site. We've taken our attend page and we have temporarily transformed it into attend/COVID-19. Our attend page is where members and other community members can usually go to find a listing of our events as well as a listing of community events. And usually we have some events that are featured, and those are usually our partner events as well as our events. What you will see now when you go to attend/COVID-19 is you will see some featured resources. The role we elected to take in providing information is to be selective. There's a lot out there, and there are a lot of other individuals and organizations that have done a great job of compiling Google Docs about just all sorts of resources. Targeted at, for everybody, and also targeted in all sorts of different ways. And so what we are doing is we're thinking of who we consider to be our primary audiences or stakeholders, for lack of better words. And so we're thinking about what we think is most pertinent for small businesses, for workers, for grassroots orgs, for artists, and then for our fellow community members. So we are pretty much filtering the resources that we are aware of through those lenses and making that available on our page. And so when you go to the Attend COVID-19 page, you'll see featured resources. And we try to provide at least one resource for each of those groups that I've mentioned. So what's featured right now is the City of Boston's Economic Development page. So that is the page that is primarily aimed at small businesses. On that page, you can find a list of Boston restaurants that are still operating that you can support. There's a delivery and takeout guide for Boston restaurants that have had to close their sit-down establishments or shut down their sit-down service. There's a survey for businesses. So this is the third iteration of that survey. So what I'm gleaning from that is the department is working with the information that they have. And then they're putting out regular surveys to acquire more information. But it allows them to have some information, to give them some guidance, and then to get more information, to get more guidance. So those are the types of things that are on that page. We also highlight the state's virtual daily town halls on unemployment. So that's important for all of us, important for our business owners, our workers, and our fellow community members. So we know that is changing a lot every few days. We know recently with the CARES Act, for example, one of the things that's in there is unemployment is being extended to people for whom unemployment is not usually made available. So freelancers, independent workers, et cetera. And even with that being in the legislation, we received an update today that states are still waiting on guidance, federal guidance. And so even though that is in the legislation, we still don't know, for example, yet how that unemployment assistance will reach people who does not usually reach. We've also highlighted Union Capital Boston's fund to help Bostonians So Union Capital Boston is sending $150 Visa gift cards to anybody who requests it. They have a form that you can fill out. They're, you know, not burdensome. They're not trying to make it difficult for people, and they're just trying to get cash into people's hands. I think the last update that I saw, they had distributed about $100,000 in cash to people. I can't do the quick math on that right now, so I won't make up the number of people or families that is. But they have also said that they are definitely oversubscribed. So they, when I last looked, had about a waiting list of about 4,000 people. So these are 4,000 people who had sent in requests. And Union Capital Boston is fundraising as they go. And so these are people who have indicated need, and they're trying to fill that need. So that's on there for two reasons. One, for people who have a resource who need to access such a resource. And the second, for people who feel like they can contribute to that resource. So as I said, they're oversubscribed, so they can definitely use funding. In that fund. We've also highlighted the Boston Artist Relief Fund. That's there. I don't have a whole lot of information on how that's operating, so definitely welcome feedback from anybody who may have more on both sides. So from the how much money is in that fund, as well as how many artists have been helped by that fund. We also highlight the economic disaster injury loan, SBA loan, that's available for small businesses. Very generous terms, and so that's there. We definitely want as many small businesses as possible to avail themselves of that resource as possible. And then we also highlight on the informational side, the CDC website, the state's website, and the city of Boston's general COVID-19 website. That's what we've done on the informational side. Also on that page, you'll see a survey that's at the bottom of those featured resources. And that's where we're asking Ujima members to provide us feedback on that page. So to let us know how helpful or not helpful it has been, and to also let us know what types of resources they're looking for, as well as, I should say, you're looking for, as well as any resources that you have found particularly valuable that you think we should be highlighting. And so if you click on that survey, we ask if you have any offers and if you have any needs. We also have our Zoom information on that page. We might have to get rid of it because those of us who joined us early were fortunate to be treated to the 21st century pandemic phenomenon of Zoom bombing. So that happened to us. And I think it was not exciting enough for the Zoom bombers to stick around for too long. So they left after a couple of minutes. So we may be pulling that down, and hopefully our members, enough of our members, it's been circulated enough to enough of our members that, such that they know how to access it. And then finally on that page, we have listings for other community events that are occurring online right now. And we always really want to encourage, whether in person or online, continue to build community, nurture relationships. And so we do have a listing of other community events that are online. And we did this month reintegrate our featured events. And so we do also have a featured events section where we highlight our events as well as partner events. And again, right now, all online. So that's one thing that that's one of our responses. The second response is we have started InReach, and we have decided, by InReach I mean member InReach, and we have decided to organize our member InReach along member teams. So we have some members of our member teams who are calling their fellow member team members, and they're calling to check in on them. to see how they're doing, and to find out if there are any needs that they have right now, find out what they're navigating right now, to be able to give some resources that we have on hand, not an unwieldy list or anything, but to be able to direct them to City Life Vida Urbana's eviction hotline, for example, if they're managing rent or mortgage, to be able to guide our small businesses to the city's economic development page, provide a place for mental health needs, et cetera. So we have an in-reach script. If you've not yet had a chance to view the script, and if you're on a member team and you'd like to be helpful with that in-reach, please definitely contact me. So and let me know what member team you'd like to help contact, and I can send you that member team's list, as well as the script, and you can feel free to ask me any questions with any pointers. It is our aim, some teams, for example, the business support team, we have said we want to try to get a good amount of in-reach done by next Wednesday, because that will allow Ujima staff to kind of go over what we've learned and what we've heard from the in-reach. And then that will allow Jenny Jeffard, who's our business alliance coach, who has the task of making sure that the business support team, the community standards committee, and our business alliance are all aligned, can take something to the next business support team meeting in that interest. So again, we're doing member in-reach. This is very important for us. We want to be able to contact all of our members, connect with all of our members, see how they're doing, and see if they have any needs, be able to direct them to any resources that we can easily direct them to. That's the second thing that we are doing. And again, if you are on a member team and you'd like to help with that in-reach, please do reach out to me as well as other Ujima staff to let us know so that we can get you started. The third thing we are doing is we are going to set up an emergency relief fund. So we were approached, I think now this is maybe a couple of weeks ago, by a supporter who asked us if we were willing to host a fund that would house stimulus check donations. We are not able to direct funds from the Ujima Fund for those purposes. And we are hosted by Center for Economic Democracy. Our fund is hosted by Center for Economic Democracy, which is our fiscal sponsor. I don't know if that's some Zoom bombing, but unfortunately.
Hello.
Okay, I think that's some Zoom bombing. Let me see if I can get rid of this person. Okay. So I don't think that person was real, or a real person, but I don't think that person was serious. We did some research and we saw that we could indeed host a fund, and so we did decide to go ahead and start the process of setting up an emergency relief fund. We have identified three primary purposes for this fund, or three primary uses of the funds. One is funds will go to our voting members. This feels appropriate to us, or our general members, as our general or voting members are residents of Boston proper. And so to us, it makes sense to, much like the Union Capital Boston Fund, to direct assistance to any voting member who needs that. Right now we are saying we will provide around $600 to each voting member that makes a request. And so we are now working on with the application process is, and again, we want to keep it low barrier, but that is one of the, that will be one of the uses of the funds in that fund. The second direction is we also are going to set aside some monies for workers of businesses in our business alliance. So we want to support the businesses that are in our founding and current business alliance. One of the things that we know from hearing from our businesses themselves, as well as being in a conversation with other organizations that support businesses, is that there is a need for grant dollars for small businesses. So I talked about the SBA loan that's available for small businesses, and there are other loan products that are being created both nationally and locally. And what has been identified as necessary along with those loan products, which are patient, which are very generous, are just outright grant dollars. And so we don't think that with this emergency fund that we will set up, that we can provide the amount of grant dollars that small businesses need. And so the best way that we think we can partner with our businesses is to do the direct outlays of cash to their employees. And so that could help to provide just some relief for the businesses who are not only managing high-level decisions about their businesses, but they're also managing how they are going to make sure that their employees are okay as well. So that will be the second use of monies from that fund. And then the third is we do want to make sure we are not competing with or displacing local mutual aid efforts that are already out there. So I've mentioned Union Capital Boston, for example. There are many other funds that have been set up. There's the Mass Undocu Fund. I talked about the city's Artist Relief Fund. There's a fund for musicians. So much like the informational resources, beautifully, there have been a lot of material resources that have been set up for different communities as well. So we want to make sure that, again, we're not competing with them, we're not displacing them, we are in partnership with them. And so we do want to have some monies go to support those efforts, because they are definitely, many of them are definitely oversubscribed. We are thinking about whether or not it makes sense for a democratic process to apply to that, being that we are at Ujima. So right now we're thinking we may be asking members to help us choose the local funds that we will be supporting with monies from this fund. So that is our third response to COVID-19. And then there's a fourth one that I wanna talk about tonight, which is on the policy and advocacy front. We are part of a few different groupings of businesses that support organizations. And so we're working to coordinate along with our peers and partners these conversations and emerge with a common platform. So one I've already mentioned, which is that our small businesses right now need grant funding and they need substantial grant funding. The other organizations that we are in the different groupings of conversations with are BECMA, Black Economic Council of Massachusetts, Foundation for Business Equity, LISC Boston, which we partner with on the Boston Builds Credit Program, MACDC, Massachusetts Association of Community Development Corporations, Boston Foundation is a part of these conversations, Amplify Latinx, Commonwealth Kitchen, and I should say it's Jen Fagel at Commonwealth Kitchen, who's really been really out there and vocal about the need for grants for small businesses right now. Just name a few. Berkshire Bank is a part of these conversations. I would say we're really starting to in our piece of this sector kind of coalesce around a common platform and speaking with a common voice about some needs. So as I said, one, I've spoken about already, grants for small businesses. And what goes along with that is also funding for TA, because, you know, before this, not only did our businesses need capital, they also needed technical assistance. That change has, that need has not changed during this time, and that need is actually amplified during this time. And then there is one more thing that I forgot in mentioning Foundation for Business Equity. Foundation for Business Equity has set up an emergency loan fund. It's a $5 to $10 million fund. It is for Black and Latinx businesses with revenues over $250,000. They are getting ready to roll out the application process for that next week. And we are partnering with them on that process and that conversation, because we think it's important, as all of us have been slammed, to not lose sight of the pre-existing racial disparities and racial wealth gap that has us doing the work that we're doing, that hasn't disappeared during this time, and that not only has not disappeared, but is exacerbated during this time. And so really making sure that our Black and Latinx businesses do not get overlooked during this time. So that's our COVID-19 response. I mentioned InReach. Is that everything that I wanted to talk about? I think it is. So I will pause. It's 7:01. I'll just pause for some questions or some feedback. And Lucas and Claudia, just shoot me a chat message if there was anything you wanted to talk with members about.
Hi, Nia. This is Joyce. Can you hear me?
Yep, I can hear you, Joyce. How you doing?
I'm okay. How are you?
Good. I'm going to just direct you to our chat box really quickly, Joyce.
Thank you.
Jenny just posted in a sign-in link if you haven't had a chance to sign in. But go ahead with your question.
I just wanted to know how much cash there was going to be for the employees, because you said 600 for voting members. So I just wanted to make sure I didn't miss if you said an amount for employees.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Joyce. I appreciate that. So also 600, which is why we felt like that would be better directed at workers of the businesses, because we felt like in the conversations that we've had, for example, when talking about grants for small businesses, and this has really been with a lot of guidance from Jen Fagel. Initially, she was saying, you know, a business would need $10,000, and now it's kind of more in the area of $60,000. So we definitely didn't think we could say with this fund to a business, you know, here's $600, and think that that would actually be helpful. But what we did think could be helpful is providing $600 for each of their workers. And again, that would just be adding some additional relief to what the businesses themselves are trying to provide already.
Right. Great. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And thank you for the question, Joyce.
Of course.
I think the other thing I should say about that emergency relief fund, and so if you've not said it yourselves, I'm sure you've heard the sentiment, which is not only is this pandemic unearthing anew the gaping holes in our society and in our systems, it's also a prompt to think about how we want things to be moving forward. And so I know I've definitely seen people saying things like, you know, we don't want to revert back to normal actually after this, as comforting as that may feel to think, you know, the primary goal right now is just to get back to normal. We also want to examine that, because we want to examine what normal was. And so if normal was a situation that has us during a crisis or an emergency, not having enough equipment for workers who have to do important work, people without paid sick time, such that their companies are endangering them and asking them to continue to work even though they shouldn't be. Universal healthcare, for example, comes up. So if we know that is what normal is, then we want to ask ourselves, do we feel better when this is over? And normal is still that, and we're not on our way to something different that has future crises or future emergencies feeling different. And I mentioned that just to say, so for Ujima, we're always forward looking and we're always future building. And so what's important for us with this fund as well is we don't see it as a temporary emergency measure that goes away. So this will be a structure, this emergency relief fund that will endure. So we will not only be fundraising for this fund for this year, we will also be fundraising for it to be funded next year as well. For us to be thinking not just about what our immediate short-term concerns are, but to really be planning, to really be doing as much long-term planning as we can do in this moment. So I think that that's an important thing to mention for this fund as well. When we were first starting out, we definitely had a lot of people who were asking us if we conceived a fund for individuals. And our response at that time was we wanted to focus on our fund now, our Ujima fund, and we wanted to get that right first before we started thinking about other funds. But as with life, sometimes life directs you otherwise. And so we have decided if we're setting up this emergency relief fund now, then we should just go ahead and make it a permanent structure. And anticipate that there will be such needs in the future, and we want to be ready and not be in that moment working to build something. Any other questions or comments? Lucas is telling me that there's something he wanted to direct people to in the agenda. And Claudia, I don't know. Yes, Claudia, you did have something you wanted to share, and it's important. So how about I kick it to you, Claudia, and then we will then kick it to Lucas. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Claudia. My pronouns are she, her, hers. This is kind of a good segue after what Nia was just talking about. We just launched something called Necessary Systems Daily as part of our social media campaign. And that's in partnership with the Collier Connection. And we just got a new partner, Nia. Who is it?
Yep, Emblem Strategic.
Emblem Strategic. And basically what we're focusing these initiatives on is, what systems do we need to put in place that uplift care within the community? So what Nia was just talking about in terms of having an already established emergency fund is an example of that. But also just how we can take care of each other. And we decided to focus on small actions that the community can do during the day. We started out with kicking off with just being able to, we did a little test run with it, and it was, we kind of focused on, just calling a friend, something as simple as that can be very impactful for someone's day through this crisis. So, phoning somebody that can't work remotely, phoning someone that lives alone, phoning someone that is at high risk, and just kind of promoting being able to check in on each other. Nia, I don't know if you're able to enable the screen sharing.
For you?
For me.
Or for you? I don't know. Let me see. So I've never tried to do screen share for anyone else. Well, how would I do that for you?
Thank you.
Oh, you know what? I don't. Okay. So here's the thing. All right.
Will we get bombed?
Right. So I actually turned off screen sharing for other participants. Do you maybe want to post something in the chat?
Yeah. I just wanted to show what we had been working on.
Yeah, maybe post it in the chat just because I think we still have some people who are trying to jump in this.
And if for some reason you can't attach it, like I know photos are hard to attach in the chat, you could also put it in the agenda in the Google Doc, which folks seem to be able to view.
So, I didn't send it to everybody.
Cool.
Yeah. So, basically, like I was saying, sorry, I rely a lot on visual communication, so that threw me off a little bit. So yeah. Basically our larger campaign kicked off with what we're calling the hashtag Necessary Systems Daily. And then we broke it down. If you saw in our previous email, we were focusing on how we can rethink systems, rethink culture, policy, ability, and economy. We took those thoughts and broke it down a little bit further into different systems in terms of how we can build our necessary systems. So we did housekeeping systems, and we cited a very great article by Rachel Miller, and it's a great resource on what to do if you live with someone who isn't taking coronavirus seriously, and also how to talk to a partner about that or roommates. And it also has links to other resources that are great tools, such as the CDC's checklist, which kind of is a great list to even check in with yourself. I've done it, I live alone. So just knowing that I have systems in place in terms of what kind of care I would need or how I could provide care to other people. And it's just really, it makes it much easier to have these conversations with people. Today, we did a post about a mutual aid system Beth Deaconess Hospital has some great resources about how to make face masks. So our mutual aid system post today focused on what you would need to make a face mask and broke that down, as well as providing a link for people on how to make a face mask. So that's what we've been up to. And you can find those on all three of our platforms. So on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. Yeah. Anything else, Nia?
I think that's it. And I do just want to say, give a shout out to Claudia and Sierra because they are rocking it on Instagram and Twitter. So thank you for that. But any questions or comments for Claudia? Okay. And now I think we'll kick it to Lucas. Lucas wanted to direct us to something on the agenda.
Yeah, just saying that if folks want to follow along as I'm giving these updates, that some of these notes are written in the agenda. So Nia, I appreciated the framing you gave at the beginning when you mentioned that this is a space to talk about ways in which we're departing from conventions. So I wanted to highlight two things. One is that at Ujima, there was a conversation we had with our attorneys where we were advised to increase the interest rate that we would charge a business if that business enters into default. And we chose not to do that. We thought that that was kind of a convention that just makes a hard situation for someone that much harder. They're already in a hole, this digs the hole deeper. So we decided not to conform with what was conventional in that expectation around how a loan fund might act. To give some examples of responses that other funds in our network, progressive funds that inspire me and ways that they're responding to COVID, I thought I'd just highlight a few things. One is Pioneer Valley Grows in Western Massachusetts. So this is a fund that primarily funds businesses in the food sector, so farmers, as an example. And they are launching a new loan, which is up to $25,000 with 0% interest, where you don't have to make payments for the first year. because for the foreseeable future, the economy is going to be impacted by COVID. So it allows a business to not worry about the first 12 months of their loan. And those are probably 3-year loans on average. That group is also calling their investors and asking if any of them would forego receiving interest payments over the life of their note, which I thought was an interesting way to alleviate the pressure that that fund would have to produce returns so that they can then lower interest for their borrowers. The Cooperative Fund of New England is launching a new product, which is also low interest, lower than their normal rate, 3%, with a deferral period of 6 months to account for folks that are struggling to adapt and respond to how the economy's been impacted. And another lender made a Slack channel for all of the companies in their portfolio so that all the companies could talk to each other and engage in creative organizing. So some of those companies came together and said, let's do some joint marketing together. And I just think generally speaking, you could think of that as building a support network for folks that can relate to each other about what it's like to be a small business owner right now. So those are examples of things that inspired me that folks are doing right now. To give quick updates on the Ujima Fund, we have raised over $2 million. That's come from community members, from,
Yeah, so just really quickly, I did ask you, because we're at 7:15, so just said we talked about the raise in the last co-direct, so it's pretty much the same information, so I don't think it's necessary right now, just because we're running out of time.
Sure, so the last thing I want to just highlight is that we have reached out to a number of businesses, as we talked about the last co-direct, to ask if they'd like to apply to join the Business Alliance. And for folks that are interested in Googling some of those business names to see who has indicated that they would like to join the Business Alliance, you can check out the agenda and look at some of those names and find out more about those companies. Seven of those companies have also asked for capital from the fund and indicated that they're going to apply. So if you want to know who's coming down the pipeline, you can take a look at those names, drop it into Google, and learn more there.
Thank you, Lucas. Any questions or comments for Lucas? Okay, we're at 7:16. Alex, you said you had to step away. Are you still there? Are you?
Well, yeah, I'm gonna go for now.
Okay.
Thanks, guys.
All right. Excellent. Thank you, Alex. Thank you for taking notes. Jenny, do you have anything?
No, I think you covered a good amount of that, but I just wanted, I'm not sure if everyone is aware of what I do. I think Mia did a really good job in covering a good amount of it. But I am the new Business Alliance coach with Boston Ujima, and my focus, primary focus is really to be a bridge and a resource to the businesses within our Good Business Alliance and act as a connector between the business support team, the community standards committee, as well as the Good Business Alliance. So we are moving forward. Our next meeting for the community standards committee is this upcoming Monday, and we would be deciding on whether or not to invite City Fresh into the Good Business Alliance, as well as reviewing another business on the docket. So any updates that from that meeting will be shared later on. And outside of that, just wishing you guys all the good vibes in the midst of all of this. And that's it for me.
Thank you. I think the only thing I want to add to that, Jenny, is when I talked about the member inreach, that also included, as I said, members of our business alliance. So Jenny's doing that. So Jenny is making calls to our founding business alliance, as well as our current business alliance members, to check in with them to see how they're doing, the decisions they have to navigate, et cetera, so that we can learn the unique needs of each of our businesses and what they're asking for. So not only is there the grants conversation and the outlays of cash to their workers, but we've gotten some specific requests. For example, Cerro Cooperative has asked us to circulate a job description on their behalf. They're hiring a sales associate right now. And they'd also like us to coordinate with them on a composting workshop that would be public, that would help them generate ideas for a wraparound ad for their truck. So they're kind of like the general needs that we know businesses have. And then we know that each business is unique. And so they're going to be very specific, unique needs that they will have So I know Casey is here from the business support team, for example. It's also a good opportunity just for us to say, we're looking to really re-engage the wider business support team. So we have around 94 people, 94 members that have signed up for that team. And so this is a really excellent moment, if you signed up for that team, to re-engage and to help us support the businesses in our alliance, as well as the businesses on the Businesses We Love list. So what I neglected to mention was that monies will be set aside for workers on the Businesses We Love list as well. So the next business support team meeting is Wednesday, April 22nd. And so if you signed up for that team and you haven't had an opportunity to engage as fully as you would like to, please reach out to Jenny and please join us and help us provide support for the businesses in our alliance, as well as the businesses we love that we anticipate investing in the future and having some type of relationship with. So I will ask one more time if there are any questions or comments about anything that you've heard tonight before we break out into our teams.
Can we get this on your website?
What was the question, Louise? I'm sorry to hear you.
Can you get this info on your website? No, you gave the info about the resources and everything?
Yes.
And the business is open?
Yes, absolutely. Yep. And I will. What I will do is type in that link where you can find it in now. So I'm putting that in the chat box now. So if you click on that link that I just put in there, Louise, you'll be able to see the page where we are housing that information and where we will update that information regularly. And it's ujimaboston.com/COVID-19. That's the link.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Louise. Okay. So we have, I think probably the easiest way is to ask who is here for the podcast team.
I mean, it's Joyce, and I don't think we're meeting tonight, actually. We've been talking on WhatsApp,